Hi, everyone. Welcome today to our annual service that we call Vision Sunday. And as always, a big hello to all of our locations and campuses all across our region, and hello to the men and women in the Alabama Department of Corrections, and to all of you who are watching today online. God bless you today. Wow, there is so much that I want to share with you about what's going on in our church, but I also want to stir your life with fresh vision and direction. I believe people need clarity in their lives more than ever before, and that's what today is all about. In fact, if you've felt lost, hopeless, or unclear about what's going on in your life, I believe today has the power to change everything. How? Vision. Vision is the ability to see clearly, and with it, vision will bring you stability, confidence, and hope, even when everything around us feels like shifting sand. The Bible says in Proverbs 29:18 that where there is no vision, the people perish. The NIV translation says that where there is no vision or revelation for your life, that people will cast off restraint. In other words, if you don't have a clear vision for your life, then you just give up. And so many have. But I'm here today to remind you that God has a wonderful plan for your life. And that plan is the only thing that will bring you real fulfillment. Now, before we get into the message, I do want to update you on a few exciting things happening here at Highlands. First of all, next Sunday, I'll begin a brand new series on the greatest sermon ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount. And for 9 weeks, we're going to study the Beatitudes, the 9 principles that Jesus taught in that sermon that are really countercultural, but bring God's blessing in our life. In fact, each of the 9 Beatitudes begin with the word blessed. Blessed are those who, and then Jesus taught principles that are so missing in our culture. So don't miss a single week. It's going to be a powerful series. I also want to give you some updates on some of the building projects that we have going on right now at Church of the Highlands. Right now, our building contractors have begun construction on permanent facilities for our McCalla and Woodlawn campuses. Our McCalla building is set to open in the summer of 2022, and our brand new Woodlawn building is set to open in the fall of 2022. Both of these buildings allow us to get out of our temporary space and have a permanent home where we can serve the people of those campuses and continue to reach the precious people in those areas. As always, we are building these facilities completely debt-free, and that's only because of your consistent generosity. Every one of our campuses give toward these projects, just like all of the campuses have given to the campus you attend. So again, thank you. I'm also thrilled to announce that our trustees have secured property in Alabaster. They're negotiating a land gift in Opelika, and we're under contract on property in the west end of Birmingham for future buildings for all 3 of these campuses. We'll announce our plans to begin construction on all of these properties in the very near future. Our trustees have also approved construction of The Lodge, a beautiful retreat facility on the Grants Mill campus property for visiting pastors to come and be trained, refreshed, and encouraged. This will enable the vision God has given us to serve local churches in every way we can, and we believe it is so needed to keep these church leaders healthy and strong. And finally, we are nearing completion on the first phase of the Highlands College campus at Grandview. We are on track to have this phase 1 project completed by the end of this year and have our students there on campus beginning in 2022. God has called us to pioneer a first-of-its-kind academy model for biblical higher education so we can send thousands of qualified young Christian leaders into a very ripe harvest field. And God is blessing it beyond anything we could have imagined. Just this past month, the Green family of Hobby Lobby generously gave $20 million to Highlands College to build the first of 2 residence halls for our students. This beautiful 5-floor facility is already under construction and is expected to be completed by the end of 2022. All of these projects are only possible because of our gracious God and by your generosity. And my prayer is that all of you feel like you're a vital part because you are. We are doing this together, and I want to say thank you. Thank you for believing in the vision God gave us and for doing your part to make a difference in our generation. From the deepest part of my heart, God bless you. And today is the first Sunday of the month, another opportunity for us to give what God has put on our hearts to give and an opportunity to honor God with our first, with our tithes and offerings. You can give today in the service with the Highlands app, or you can give online. You can even give by texting the word Highlands and the amount you'd like to give to 77977. And as always, just ask God what you should do and just do what he tells you. Again, thank you for being a part of this great vision God has given us. And in the same way that God has given our church vision, God has a special, unique, and exciting vision for your life as well. Literally from cover to cover, the Bible shows how God has always wanted four things for you. We call them the four steps in your spiritual journey to be in a relationship with God, to settle the issues of your past, to find out what your life is really all about, and then to do something with your life that makes an eternal difference. Here at Highlands, we say it this way: you can know God, find freedom, discover your purpose, and make a difference. Now, if you've been around Highlands for any amount of time, you've heard us talk about these four visions for your life. But today, I want to give them to you in pictures. And the first picture is the picture of a butterfly coming out of the cocoon. It's always amazing to see the dramatic change that happens from the caterpillar to the butterfly. And it gives the picture of what God can do in all of us. You probably know that the scientific word for the change from the caterpillar to the butterfly is the word metamorphosis. The definition of that word is the change of the form or nature of a thing or person into a completely different one by natural or supernatural means. It's the same word that's used in 2 Corinthians 5:17, where the Bible says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here." Now, we all know that we need change in our life, but for many, they've only had a religious type experience, one where they try to change by trying hard to be a better person or by just trying to do some things externally without any real change happening on the inside. Now, if you've ever tried that, it's frustrating and it doesn't work. Real Christianity is like that butterfly, where God takes all the ugliness of our past and completely transforms us into a new person through the power of the cross of Jesus Christ.
Grew up in the church, grew up in a Christian household with Christian parents. You know, we had just a happy life. I mean, everything went well until I hit about middle school. The school that I went to, there was a lot of rules and, you know, regulations, and I was always one to, I guess, kind of want to go my own way and do my own thing. And I just became very discontent, searching for significance, meaning in life, security, and I went searching in the world. And I thought, if I can just get high, then I'm gonna find fulfillment in that. That's gonna fix everything that's wrong with me. My addiction went, you know, to a whole nother level the day that my marijuana dealer introduced me to crack cocaine. I was just trying to escape every day. I was so depressed. I was completely defeated and in utter darkness. I can just remember waking up every day and wishing that I would die or that I had died in my sleep. That I did not want to go on. I did not want to face another day. I had a lot of legal issues, and I went in front of a judge, and I had violated my probation, and she said, "You have a choice. You can either go to prison or you can go to the Lovelady Center." So of course, I said, "Well, I will go to the Lovelady Center." I knew that this place was the real deal, that it was different. And I wanted what these people had, and I was ready to change my life for me. And I just ran back into the arms of Jesus, and I just had this moment where the Holy Spirit just came into my life, and He told me, "You will never deal with this again." And it was just broken off in that moment to where I had no desire for it. I had no desire to ever go back. And at that place, I was able to just surrender everything to Jesus. I became a new creation. When I think about where I was and where I am today, and that He's the one that brought me out of it all, that He's the one that set me free, that it wasn't anything else. God used Church of the Highlands, God used the Lovely Center, but ultimately it was Him that brought me out. It was His Spirit that set me free. He is a miracle-working God, and there's no person that's too far gone. There's hope for everyone. He's a redeeming God, and He has redeemed everything. He has restored to me all of the years that the enemy stole from me. And now I'm married, we have two daughters, and now I live my life every day on fire for Jesus. I'm beyond grateful for Him coming in and transforming my life and setting me free.
I always love hearing stories of life change, and I want to personally invite you to know God. If you've never given your life to Jesus, you're gonna get that opportunity before this service is over. And if you are a Christian, but have walked away from the Lord and started maybe living your life on your own, before this service is over, you're gonna get the opportunity to come back home. Now, many of you have made that decision in the recent weeks and months. And you would need to know that the Bible says that your next step is to go public with your faith with water baptism. I want to encourage you to follow the example that Jesus Himself set to be water baptized. The Bible says that baptism demonstrates the change that has occurred in our life. I want to read it to you out of 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21. It says this, it says, "In baptism, we show that we've been saved from death and doom by the resurrection of Christ, not because our bodies are washed clean by the water, but because in being baptized, we are turning to God and asking Him to cleanse our hearts from sin." So if your heart has really been transformed by God, then it's important to let others know. And the way we do that is through water baptism. And that can happen today. Today we are offering water baptism after every service and at every campus. And I am personally inviting you to take this next step, this very important step in your spiritual journey. Don't put it off a single day. We have everything you need, even if you didn't come prepared. We have clothes, underwear, towels. We even have photographers to capture this important moment in your faith. Now, your campus pastors will give you all of the details at the end of this service, but I'm asking you to go ahead and make up your mind to do what Jesus asked us to do, and that is to go public with our faith with water baptism today. Now, if you've already given your life to God, it's time to go to the next step in your spiritual journey, and that is to find freedom. Freedom from what, you might ask? It's freedom from the issues, the habits, the hangups, the hurts, the mistakes, all the things that continually hold us back from God's best. And the picture of this step is the table. The table is the place where relationships are formed and strengthened. The Bible teaches that God uses authentic relationships with other believers as the means by which we form life-changing relationships and then work through our issues. I'm inviting you to not just know God, but to find freedom at a table with other Christians in what we call small groups. Groups give us a place to learn, pray, and support each other through the process of growth that we really all need. And today, we're launching thousands of brand new small groups, groups of every type, for every interest, for every need. Now, today marks the beginning of our fall small group semester, and you can go online and use our search engine to sort through the vast array of groups and opportunities to find the perfect one for you. And then, Sit at the table with them for the next 13 weeks and watch what God will do in and through you. You'll discover how this big church becomes very small. And you'll see the reality of James 5:16 in your life, where the Bible says, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other and you'll be healed. This is what happens at the table, healing. God designed your spiritual health and your growth to take place in the safety of small group relationships. Ask anyone who has been in a small group and they'll tell you that real life change happens in the context of authentic relationships. It happens at the table.
So I started fishing at a young age. My dad was always big into bass fishing. And I mean, right out of the gate, I was probably eating cookies and drinking Kool-Aid under the steering wheel while my dad fished. And that was babysitting back then. As soon as I could make a cast, you know, I had a Snoopy rod in my hand and then a bait caster and then never checked up. The more I kind of got into it, I started fishing some competitive tournaments. And then we started a team at Auburn University when I was in school there. We had some success and all. And then I started working for some of the companies. I had an awesome time. I got to meet all of my, you know, heroes from growing up in the fishing industry. And at some point, it became the thing I turned into an idol. I was working about 225 days a year. I'd get up at 4 a.m. and work till midnight. I was just kind of on this nonstop pace of work, 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 fish, 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 work in the fishing industry. And, you know, it took 5 or 6 years to get there, but I got to where I was just miserable. I remember one time I backed the boat in, pulled the truck up, parked it, went down there and got in the boat, untied it from the dock, and just kind of sat there for about 10 minutes. And pulled back up, tied up to the dock, went and got the truck, took the boat out, and never made a cast. And that was one of the scariest times for me because it had always been enough. Like, fishing was always kind of my source. If I had to go, you know, clear my head or, you know, anything, I could always go there. And it didn't do anything for me anymore. I had been drinking for 4 or 5 months. It led to a lot of depression. It was a tough road to go down by yourself. I'd never been more desperate and more miserable and more lonely. I didn't want to be on this planet anymore. Like, I was done. I was just existing. I'd get up and go to work, drink, get up, go to work, drink. You know, I wouldn't drink for 3 or 4 months, and that'd be all right, but it's still miserable, and to the point I would get back to drinking, you know? I was like, what's this? There's more to it than this. And I was like, God, what do I do? You know, what do I do? And I cried out to God, like, God, just help me. What do I do, you know? And as clear as anything ever has in my life, small groups flashed in my mind. And I'd heard about small groups. I'd gone to Highlands. That's the only instruction I had, so that's the first step I took, the first step of obedience I'd probably taken to God in a long time. He honored it massively, so I jumped into the Young Professional Small Group. I would just surrender little by little, and all of a sudden, the weight was gone. I was dependent on God the way I was supposed to be, you know, the way I was designed to be. What you don't realize until you start opening up is everybody's dealing with the same stuff. I was just in a miserable place. And he pulled me out, and he put me on solid rock. God used all those relationships I started to build in small groups, and he would use them for the places I was the weakest. It's totally changed my entire life, my entire course, by going in just that one simple step of obedience. All I had to do was come to him, and I was too proud and stubborn along the way. And then in that one moment of sheer surrender, he answered, and it's changed my entire life.
Shay's story could be your story. And I think that more than ever before, we need the accountability and support of a group of friends. So go on our website today, use the search engine that we've designed to help you sort through all of the groups to find the one that's perfect for you. Now, if you can't decide what type of group to be in, let me recommend that you consider joining what we call a freedom group. This is the only group that all of us need to attend once in our time here at Highlands. It only takes one semester to go through this curriculum that really closes the door on the things of our past and the things that hold us down. So if you can't decide what type of group is best for you, check out the freedom groups. All right, let's review. We start by knowing God, and the picture is a butterfly. And then we find freedom with the picture of the table. But here's where the vision gets even more exciting And that's when we discover our purpose. And the picture is a ladder. And each rung of that ladder are steps that God invites you to take. Steps to discover your purpose, your potential, and your calling. As Mark Twain says, the greatest days of your life are the day you were born and then the day you discovered why you were born. So how do we discover it? Well, we believe that your design reveals your destiny. In other words, how God made you points to what he has called you to do. Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16 says it this way. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know that full well. Watch this. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. What an awesome thought that your life is planned by God to do something significant and meaningful. And it not only gives you meaning, but I really believe it's critical for your life too. Critical so that our life doesn't end up meaningless and focused on the wrong thing. In the Bible, the Apostle Paul said, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task Jesus has given me. Now, what was Paul saying? He was basically saying that you'll never find what your life is really all about until you discover the purpose that God has for you. And when you do discover it, then life can't derail you and hurt you like it does so many others. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4 that when you had this clear focus for your life, that we don't lose heart anymore. Though outwardly we are being wasted away, inwardly we're being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them. Watch this. So we fix our eyes, not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary and what is unseen is eternal. Now, Paul certainly had his share of problems, trouble with the Jewish leaders, persecuted by the Roman government, shipwrecks, jail time, loneliness, and a lot of bad days. But none of these had a negative effect on him like they would have had on so many others. Why? Because Paul wasn't focused on them. He had something bigger in his life that he was focused on, and that was his God-given purpose. Now, here's the good news, that even though you may not know what that purpose is, you already have a purpose. You just have to take hold of the rungs of the ladder and discover it, and we want to help. And by the way we do that here at Highlands is through the monthly growth track, and it starts again today. These three classes will give you the information you need to join the church, help you discover the unique gifts and talents that God has put inside of you, and then we'll help you find a place to live out that purpose and calling. Now, your campus pastor will make sure you know how you can attend these three classes on the growth track today, but know this, when you take hold of the ladder, rung by rung, you'll discover your purpose and your life will have new focus and you'll love the view God has for your life.
My parents were pastors, so I grew up in church. But I was constantly striving to serve because they saw skill sets, they saw things in me and tried to make it work, but it just didn't fit. I felt defeated because it was all about like how much can I do in order to have that safety net of salvation. At the end of the day, the results was I was just drained and burnt out. I never heard of the concept of serve from your overflow until I came here. You pull into the parking lot and somebody's like on the street with a vest on, like waving at you. It's like, welcome to church. And I'm like, glad to be here. Just want to sneak in. And then you get greeted. And then you see an usher who's delighted to find a seat just for you. What I quickly realized is because people are walking in those passions, because people are doing what God literally created them to do, it's easy for them to serve. It is truly adding souls to the kingdom because I was ministered to before I even walked into the auditorium. You know, I went to the growth track. It wasn't they had a position for me and like do it. It was more like, hey man, what do you want to do? Like, what has God called you to? And I'm like, huh, so you're gonna take what I like doing and put me in a position to do that, to benefit the kingdom, I'm like, that's like a no-brainer. And I took the assessment, and I'm like, yeah, that's true. I really do like pastoring people. I really do like ministering to people. I get to do that every single, not Sunday, but every single day in my job, my vocation, at home with my family. Just being able to serve people out of the pureness of how God created me and the passions that he put inside of me. It seems so simple, but yet it's so fulfilling. And I feel like everyone should take the opportunity to experience it. If I could offer one solution, is just to take your step, go to Growth Track, get on a team, lead a group. They don't ask you to be perfect. They just ask you to show up and be available and ask God, what do you want me to do in this? What do you have for me in this? What do I need to learn? And I promise you, he will reveal it. He will show himself strong and mighty. He will fill your heart. He will encourage you. You got to take that step. You take that step, you find your purpose, you can make a difference, and you won't regret it. You won't regret the time. You won't regret the energy. You won't regret the sacrifices. It's all worth it. It is all worth it.
This is our vision, to know God, find freedom, discover purpose, so that we can do what is needed more than ever before, so that we can do what we're all on this planet to do, and that is to make an eternal difference in the lives of others. This is our real purpose in life. Jesus said it this way, "This is to my Father's glory that you, Christians, bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." Now watch this. He says, "And I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." Now, notice this isn't just a command from the Lord to live a life bearing fruit. It's a recipe for lasting joy. We know real joy does not come from making a lot of money. Real joy doesn't come from pursuing physical pleasure. Real joy doesn't come from material possessions. Real joy comes from knowing your life is productive. Real joy springs from knowing you're making a difference for eternity. And when you know you're living out your God-given purpose and you're making a difference in other people's lives, it's gonna change your outlook on life. Proverbs 11:25 says, "The generous will prosper, and those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed." But here's the catch. And it's this, that one is too small a number to make a difference. We need each other. And that's why our final picture is joined hands. That's what the Dream Teamers do every day. They join hands with the rest of the body of Christ, each doing their part, serving our church as ushers, greeters, small group leaders, worship leaders. They're in children's ministry, prison ministry, prayer ministry. They show the love of God to our cities through outreaches, serve days, and in every way they can. They know God. They've found freedom. They've discovered their purpose. And every day they join hands with the rest of the body of Christ, and they're making a difference for all eternity.
So we met in middle school. We started dating.
We were together ever since that point and started going to church together.
He invited me to Highlands. We went through all the conferences. We went to all the motion nights.
The motion conferences, I think, really stirred our faith. That's really the time where both of us went all in with God. Coming out of college and going to those last motion conferences, I realized that I had, you know, this kind of calling and this burden on my heart for, you know, the students around me. And so we knew that we both had a heart for that. After we got married, we knew that we wanted to find a campus home that was both of ours. And the apartment we found is right across the street from the Grandview campus. We started attending Grandview for a few months.
Our next step was serving. It was being connected to a group of people who had our same passions. So when we took that step, we were a little insecure about, hey, is this really, are we called for this? Are we equipped for this?
We started serving in kids and students, getting involved in the church and having these encouraging voices and getting to see the difference we're making in the lives of the kids was really refreshing and life-giving. Now we get to help serve students and kids through that same time of life that was so pivotal to us.
Being able to see the students, see them grow, helps me to become just deeper in my walk with Christ, being able to serve others and see that impact.
Just kind of being on the sidelines isn't enough anymore, where you just, you know how good that God's been and you want to share that with people. You feel the need to start making a difference. The results of that and how it really impacts people. We definitely would never go back.
All this isn't possible without God. To Him be the glory for seeing all these kids get saved, their lives being impacted, even impacting our marriage, seeing us be able to be poured into and pour into others. It's all because of God. That's the whole reason we're here, to make an eternal impact in these kids' lives and in ours.
It's a blessing from Him and Him alone that we get the opportunity to share what we know to be so real and so good with these kids. And the reason we want to serve is simply because we know how good God is. And because of that, we want all of them to experience that goodness. And we're just thankful that He's let us be some small part of that.
I hope you've been inspired by today's message. I hope you not only heard the vision, seen it in Scripture, but you've also seen it in pictures. The butterfly, the table, the ladder, and joined hands. I also hope you've enjoyed some of the stories of some of the people of Highlands who have taken that spiritual journey and shown us all what God can do in all of us. I hope you have a clear vision of what God wants to do through you as an individual and through us as a local church. And I want to personally invite you to come along for the ride. If you want to grow in your faith, then it's time for you to get in the game. It's time for you to personally take these four steps in your spiritual journey. I personally invite you to come and join us and be a vibrant part of this local church in all of the areas of vision that God has given us. And for those of you who are already a part, let's continue to pray, serve, and give, especially in this season where there are so many hurting people and people who need God. And someday, and I think probably sooner than later, we're gonna see Jesus. And we're gonna hear Him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. I love this. Now enter into the joy of your Lord." Matthew 25:23. Let's bow for prayer. Father, I thank You for giving us vision, for letting us be a part of what You're doing on planet Earth. God, we commit our plans, every one of them, to You. Every campus, every building, every small group, and every person. We're asking for Your favor, Your blessing, Your anointing. Help us to do Your will and to reach as many people as we can for eternity. Lord, thank You so much for this amazing church, for their generosity and for their faithfulness. God, we only want to hear You say to us one day, "Well done." So God, I pray for every person here today that You would light a fire on the inside of them to live their lives for You. God, I'm asking You to give them boldness to take their next steps and not to put it off. Lord, help them, I pray, God, to navigate through the journey that You have them with grace and blessing. God, I thank You for what You're doing here today. And I want you to just keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed. As I said earlier, if you're far from God, or if you don't know God, or you just feel lost, but you want to have a real relationship with Jesus, you're going to get that opportunity right now. You know, people ask me all the time, what does it take to be saved? What does it really take? And it's actually very simple, but it will cost you everything. Jesus gave you His life, and He wants the same commitment from you. You give Him your life. And you can do that right now in a simple prayer in just a moment. In fact, just a moment, I'm gonna turn the service back over to your campus pastor, who will continue to pray for you and tell you what's next. But I'm gonna lead you through this prayer of salvation right now. If you're ready to be saved, or you wanna come back to God today, you wanna give Him your life, then I want you to close your eyes and whisper these words right there where you're seated. Everyone, just say this with me. Say, "Father, thank You for sending Jesus, Your Son, to pay for my sins. I've realized today that I need you, and I cannot live my life without you. And I want you to say this to him. Forgive me for going my own way, and forgive me of my sin. Today, I change my direction, and I repent. Today, I give my life to you, everything. And I invite your son, Jesus, to be the Lord of my life. Now make this declaration with me. Come on, say it with me. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died, was buried, and he rose again. Thank you for saving me. In your name I pray, amen.